nothing says family more than children's aid societies, and smash them apart. And look, we have to have care of children beyond family because there are abusive parents. But frankly, I wonder how much influence and authority the CSs do have. And some people say they're more powerful than God. We'll get to that in a few moments' time. Michael P. Clark, family lawyer. Welcome back to the show. More Powerful Than God. That's the title of a documentary, right?
Yes, it is, Michael. It's a documentary that was created by Esther Bukareff. It's called Powerful as God, the Children's Aid Societies of Ontario. Very, very important film.
Yeah, it is. And again, that there are families that cannot be together. If a parent is abusive, the children have to be protected. But you know far more than I do, but I know cases where nothing has really happened. Then maybe someone once lost their temper or an accusation has been made, particularly at this time of year. Families are just pulled apart and there's nothing that can be done.
Well, Michael, the probably the most common reason for Children's Aid Society intervention relates to what they call neglect, parental neglect. And often parental neglect is as a result of poverty. So you have parents who are poor, and maybe all they need is a rent subsidy or a daycare space, something to help them. But what often happens is, on the basis of tips, many of which are anonymous, the society will come in, and the first response often is to just take the child away from the parent and put them in what's called foster care. And foster care often is much more damaging than leaving the child with the parent.
And I can only imagine that those sort of parents, those sort of people, are the least likely to know lawyers, to be able to afford lawyers. It must be hellish for them.
They're at a terrible disadvantage because they are usually on the margins of society, as we say, and often all they need is help. But what happens is when the society comes in and they assess the situation, and as we've said before, there's a financial incentive to put children into foster care because that's how the Children's Aid Societies receive their funding.
And this is very important that people realize this, that because otherwise they might wonder why this is going on. It is in, we're not saying that these people are morally corrupt, but it is in their financial advantage to say, we took a child out of an abusive home.
Yes, of course. And instead, I would suggest that the funding formula should change so that societies are rewarded for keeping families together and really providing help to the parents. What happens is when the society becomes involved and they apprehend a child and take the child away from the parents, they have to return the matter to court within 4 days, and it's mandated by statute. So the 4 days goes by, and the parent comes, and usually they don't have a lawyer. They don't know who the lawyers are, and they can't qualify for legal aid, perhaps. And the society comes there, and they've got all their material together, and they've got their lawyers, and the social workers have been working on this. And so the parents have a real disadvantage. And the other problem with the apprehension process is it immediately creates an adversarial situation so that it's the parents versus the society. And often the society will conduct itself in a manner that's designed to win the case. And it's not to help the parents or the child necessarily. It's to win the case and to justify their position.
Okay. Now, you've forgotten more about judges than I will ever know, but I've met some who have been dreadful, but generally I've been quite impressed with the standard, the integrity of the judges I've met. And they're pretty worldly people, and they see through things quite quickly, particularly Children's Aid Societies and bureaucrats and lawyers. Judges in this situation, do they not say, well, hold on one moment, let's hear the parent, there's no representation here, let's give them a bit of a chance?
The judges have a very difficult position, Michael, as I'm sure you can appreciate it. And one of the reasons is you don't want to be the judge who returns the child to the abusive parents and then whose name is all over the papers the next day and look at this awful situation. But you're quite right. We're fortunate in Hamilton to have a dedicated family law bench, and all these judges, all they hear are family law cases, and they're quite adept at it. But I remember having a conversation off the record with an experienced family court judge, and she told me that what's required here are grandmothers to help parents as opposed to the young social workers that come right out of school. And she had a very practical, this judge had a very practical, common sense approach to things, and you're quite right. You know, they often see or try to see what's behind the reasons for the trouble.
You mentioned judges being understandably reluctant to return a child and then being exposed as the judge who didn't get it. But that would apply to social workers too. I mean, that they may want to do the best thing, although some of the younger ones, you wonder what they're learning at university. But if they do return a child and a tragedy happens and that child is killed the next day or 2 days later, well, that would be the end of their career and certainly the end of their reputation.
Well, that happens far less than one might expect. It's a tiny, tiny fraction of cases that are dealt with on a daily basis. But those cases do get a lot of press. And the inevitable response by the society is, we missed it. Mm. And the reason why we missed it is because we're overworked, or we don't have enough money, or various other reasons. So the society is trying to excuse the fact that they've been horribly negligent in certain cases. I don't buy that argument. I don't accept that argument, because I've long advocated that the society doesn't use its resources responsibly. Taking a child away from a parent is the most intrusive, expensive method that a society can undertake. The societies receive $1.5 billion a year. They have no trouble building brand new gleaming offices, hiring lawyers, having the best technology. And recently they wanted to, I remember they wanted in Hamilton to have GPS monitors for each of their social workers out in the field. Well, these people have cell phones. I've not heard of a situation where a social worker has been assaulted or put in danger by a parent. So it's that kind of overkill, and often we see in an organization like the society, as they move along, their conduct is more designed to preserving the interests of the organization as opposed to furthering the interests of the people they're supposed to help.
Very interesting indeed. Thank you so much.
Thank you.